All right, are we live? Sounds like it. Well, thank you everybody for coming. I think we've got some interesting subjects to discuss today with regards to the U.S. relationship with Russia and where we're going to go going forward in terms of policy. We certainly live in interesting times. We live in now what's the so-called post-factual world. It's rife with propaganda. It's full of surplus information that people don't know how to digest. And I'm not sure we can really predict what exactly the actions of the next administration will be. But I think we can talk about today what they should be, and I hope there are some open ears out there in the policy community listening to us today. Unpredictability, as President-elect Trump has said, can be a good thing. But that tends to be in wartime. Predictability in peacetime is crucially important, especially when nuclear weapons are involved. And I recall an event a while back where Admiral Mullins talked about the only real threat to the United States, the only existential threat being the Russian nuclear arsenal. So we have to consider that. And we also have to consider that this is not a wartime for the United States. Yes, we are battling terrorism in multiple places around the world, but when it comes to Russia, we are at peace with Russia, even though the relationship might be rocky. We're essentially living in a gray zone period of time. Are we in a post-Cold War era? Are we in a post-post-Cold War era? We were discussing the other day during a podcast recording with General James Dubik that it's what he calls the pre-something era. I think both the United States and Russia have a responsibility to make sure this is not the pre-something horrible era. And that's crucially important in the coming years. So we need to focus. With the exception of nuclear weapons today, you know, U.S. policy has not been geared towards Russia because we didn't see anything explicitly wrong. The Cold War was a different era. We haven't seen anything really wrong since then. But Russia doesn't see it that way, and frankly, neither should we. Along a number of fronts, U.S. and Russian interests are clearly diametrically opposed. Along others, that's not necessarily the case, and we need to identify those and work on those issues together. But either way, we need to start thinking of ways we can move forward. And I don't think we're calling for a reset of relations. You know, reset means essentially turning it back to the original settings, starting over. And I'm not sure where that point would be if we attempted another so-called reset. So that being said, we're going to look at a number of issues today that the U.S. faces with Russia and hopefully identify some ways we can move forward on it. So to my right, I have Matthew Rojansky. He's the director of the Kennan Institute at the Wilson Center. From 2010 to 2013, he was a deputy director of the Russia and Eurasia program at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. And from 2007 to 2010, he served as executive director of the Partnership for Secure America. To his right is Dr. James Lewis. He's a senior vice president of director and director of strategic technologies program at CSIS. He's the author of Cybersecurity for the 44th Presidency. Before joining CSIS, he worked at the Department of State and at Commerce as a Foreign Service officer and as a member of the Senior Executive Service. And rounding out the panel on the right, we have Marc Schleifer, who's the Regional Director of Eurasia and South Asia at the Center for International Private Enterprise. Prior to joining CIPE, he was a program officer for Russia and Ukraine at the National Endowment for Democracy. He worked at the Eurasia Foundation in Moscow, lived there for 10 years, I believe, and was also at the Moscow office and law firm at Shadbourne and Park LLP. So let's have a round of applause for our panelists, and we'll get started. Matt, if you could begin.
Thank you very much, Matthew. I'm appreciative of the opportunity to speak here. It's significant for me, not only because of the subject matter, which is my life, but because in that previous life of mine that Matthew mentioned, when I ran the Partnership for a Secure America, whose acronym was PSA, ASP was a frequent partner, and despite what the letter order, the sequence of the letters would suggest to you, we were not, in fact, diametrically opposed. We tended to agree about a lot of things. So I really appreciate the opportunity to be back here. I want to try and lay out the waterfront on what I think might be both the state of the U.S.-Russia relationship from January onward, and I think the potential path forward in light of what we have seen and heard so far. But Let me be clear that this is in many respects the blind leading the blind. We don't know a lot so far about what the shape of the new administration will be. We don't necessarily know what dynamics we may think we know. Certainly the media would like to believe that they know, but we don't necessarily know what dynamics between the future White House administration and the Kremlin are likely to be. So starting from the campaign, I won't retrace a lot of well-known ground other than to say that the issues which then-candidate Donald Trump chose, I would say relatively consistently, to comment on publicly were the big issues in the U.S.-Russia relationship, ranging from Ukraine, Crimea, sanctions, to the U.S. relationship with various key allies, including our NATO allies. And the sorts of approaches, though I think the candidate himself would not have said that he was putting forward anything resembling a comprehensive policy framework, but the sorts of approaches that he took definitely diverged from what had been the mainstream position, both in his party and broadly speaking in Washington, the so-called Washington establishment. And that's a term, by the way, that Russian observers of the United States are probably more comfortable with than Americans. I think some of us might have trouble putting our finger on exactly what is the Washington establishment, but no Russian ever would. And to them, by the way, I think Hillary Clinton very much represented that establishment. What's interesting when you look at the Russian reaction to the campaign and then to the result of the election is that most of its most notable gleeful, celebratory initial response was focused on the zero-sum horse race of the election itself. And there the choice for, you know, most Russians was clear, including the Kremlin, and that was they really would have preferred not to see a Hillary Clinton administration, and indeed they won't get one. But now that that zero-sum choice is behind us, the question of how a Trump administration will govern and how it will actually manage a relationship with Moscow, wherein it will be responsible for stewarding very long-standing U.S. interests, is not necessarily one that gives any great comfort to Russians. And we're beginning already to hear this in the way that Vladimir Putin is speaking publicly about his likely future interactions, not so much personally with the President of the United States, but with the United States. So again, going back to this notion that there is some kind of greater momentum, some sort of establishment consensus with which he'll still have to contend. I think it also underscores a question of worldview. If you look at the foreign policy concept that was signed by executive order into law by President Putin just about a week ago, so 3 weeks after the U.S. election, knowing full well that he would be dealing not with Hillary Clinton but with Donald Trump, that document is almost uniformly consistent with the Russian position over the last 2 or 3 years. It lays out a world in which international law is being challenged and threatened primarily by the United States, in which dangerous non-state actors are being empowered, left to run rampant by the irresponsible or incompetent or in some instances nefarious actions, again, of the United States, and in which U.S.-led blocks and regional alignments and so-called plural unilateralism, that is to say sort of false multilateralism, coalitions of the willing and things like that, are skewing the global power balance such that the kind of rightful big power actors of the world, again, this is Putin's view as channeled through the Russian foreign policy doctrine, the Russias, the Chinas, the Indias, perhaps others, are not able to play the appropriate and rightful role that they should. Mind you, this is a worldview that remains true by the Kremlin's lights even after the election of Donald Trump. What I think also remains true, and this is interesting and maybe a little bit counterintuitive, is that despite a drumbeat of propaganda about the hollowness and dishonesty of American democracy, and in particular of American democracy promotion globally, but of course, you know, the epicenter of that is the American democracy itself, Russians then watched as the candidate that they were told was challenging the establishment and couldn't possibly unseat that sort of conspiratorial, all-powerful, democracy-promoting, regime-changing establishment, did exactly that. And the counterintuitive conclusion here is, rather than then saying, well, in fact, it's all a show and there's a second layer of conspiracy and you know, nothing has really changed, if you read Russian social media and you read comments by folks who are, I would say, by no means darlings of the liberal opposition or of the West, they are rethinking what democratic pluralistic politics means because of what they're seeing, not only in the United States, but in Western Europe as well. So there's no doubt that we're at a moment of crisis and inflection for Western democratic institutions, broadly speaking. This point has been drummed home infinitely. I don't mean here to beat that dead horse, but only to say that there are some interesting ramifications of that within Russian politics. Nothing that we can or should seek to control, but something we should watch very closely. Okay, that's the campaign and the outcome and the Russian reaction. Very quickly, the opportunity. I do think that there is an opportunity, and it's because, again, speaking of the fundamental nature of American democracy and our institutions, they're about renewal. So whether you agree or disagree with the incoming administration, whether you voted for them or didn't, it's an opportunity to start on a new course in any number of areas where that might make sense to do. So the question naturally presents itself, what would be those areas? And I would suggest that of the two major streams of current US response to Russia, and it is a very responsive, I would even say reactive policy, there's one where it makes a lot of sense to put aside the previous administration's approach and try a new tack, and another where it would make more sense, I think, to try to take advantage of the momentum that we've got. The first, of course, is isolation. So the Obama administration's approach in the aftermath of Russia's intervention in Ukraine was no business as usual. No meetings in order to establish contact, no discussions about anything other than solving the problems which the Russians have now created and you know, sort of vital global security issues. And the problem with this approach has been that we're seeing the costs and consequences of not having that dialogue across the board. I think most dramatically illustrated over the summer and late last year, when we saw some really scary near-miss incidents in the Baltic region, over the Eastern Mediterranean, Syria, and even in the Black Sea region. And I think we'll see more of those as long as we don't have dialogue in place. And that dialogue may not be aimed at any particular outcome. We may not be negotiating there a Russian withdrawal from Ukraine, but we're still going to need dialogue in order to manage the risks of this kind of escalatory tendency. That's just one example. I think there are a lot of others where isolation is both impossible to achieve in fact and also doesn't really advance our national interests. It puts an artificial standard out there that, for instance, when Secretary Kerry meets with Foreign Minister Lavrov, he appears to be departing from the policy. So that somehow is a political defeat for the administration, even if it is nominally consistent with the approach they've had all along. So again, the advantage of renewal, the advantage of new opportunities, the Trump administration doesn't even have to get into the weeds on this, just says, you know what, we're taking a different approach. And by the way, Trump paid the political cost for adopting that approach during the campaign already. When he said he'd meet, he'd negotiate with Vladimir Putin, he paid that price. On sanctions, though, here it seems to me there's not much sense in talking about sanctions relief just because. Sanctions were a response to what Russia did, what Russia has done and what it continues to do. Now, Russia does many other things for which we don't sanction it, and many countries do many things which we object to but which we don't impose sanctions for. So this is not my justification of sanctions on some sort of absolute universalist framework, but they're there, and they took a pretty heavy lift to get them into place. And they're coordinated plus or minus with Europe. Having put all of that work in, and I hope this isn't a sunk cost fallacy, and I don't want to steal your thunder either, Marc, I would simply say it doesn't make sense to give up something for nothing. Which brings me to my final point, and that's, you know, what might be the agenda? And I'm just going to say in very, very broad terms, because I want to get us to the discussion, that I think you've got to start with the premise that to even have the conversation on the highest level, and it's pretty clear that both sides are looking for that. I read Mr. Trump's statements to indicate that he would be open to a summit meeting as president with Vladimir Putin. He even talked about possibly doing it before inauguration. I would assume that includes also meeting after inauguration. I'm not sure. He may change his mind. And I'm pretty sure Putin remains consistently interested in the kind of high-level blessing, dignification that comes with a summit meeting with the President of the United States. And an opportunity is going to arise. I apologize, I didn't do my research, but maybe one of you can Google up quickly what the next, you know, G20 summit or APEC or whatever will be the opportunity. There's going to be one, and the question will present itself, do these two guys have a meeting? Whether it's a 20-minute handshake, grip and grin, or it's a 3-hour substantive negotiation, that I think depends on the staff work that's done in advance. So of course I'd love to know who the staff are. That would be helpful. I think we have a pretty good sense of who you need to talk to on the Russian side. And I just would suggest that the shape of the conversation is nested loops. If I were clever, I'd have a nesting doll analogy all worked out for you, but I don't. It just kind of goes like this. You don't deal with the bloody mess of Syria, whatever shape that's in come late January, February, March, whenever this conversation is being had. And it may be much, much worse. It may be better. It may be easier, if not necessarily better, in the sense that Mr. Assad may have basically taken over most of the country. Either way, if Syria remains a political liability, there's no conversation. You can't do a summit in an environment where the United States is being, you know, bludgeoned, embarrassed, shamed, and put under enormous political pressure by continuing humanitarian tragedy in Syria and massive migration flows pressuring our European friends and allies. If you can create a situation where there's enough calm, enough peace to actually do a meeting, then the question is, what do you talk about? I think you have to talk about Ukraine. So this is counterintuitive. I think a lot of folks would say, kind of agree to disagree about Ukraine and talk about all the things we haven't been talking about. And I agree we need to get to those things, but I actually think you've got to go through the core dilemma of this relationship if you want to get anywhere. And I don't think there's an alternative to Minsk, but I think embracing it full on, I think for the United States to say, we are actually prepared to talk directly to the Russians in the Normandy format, without the Normandy format, with our Ukrainian friends, when necessary, without our Ukrainian friends, we're ready to have the conversations, would already be progress. Again, something a new administration can do without paying much political price for it. But then our main demand is implementation of Minsk. And that's where I come back to this point about sanctions. Don't give up something for nothing. The sanctions are in place. We talked about 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, the administration would repeat over and over, off-ramp, off-ramp. What's the off-ramp for Russia? I haven't heard them use that word for at least a year. So my question would be, can the new administration put some effort on the staff level into defining what that off-ramp might look like and adequately incentivizing the Russians? And again, Marc, maybe you can comment on what it might look like and how the private sector might respond, how Europe is already responding, anticipating such a thing. But that, it seems to me, is the beginning of a quid pro quo for progress on Minsk. And I think once you've unraveled sort of those two nested problems, then you can get to the rest of the relationship. And in the interest of time, maybe I'll leave it there.
Fantastic comments. Moving on to issues of cyber, we have Dr. Lewis.
It's not really cybersecurity, and it's a mistake to think of it that way. I have a somewhat more jaundiced view of the Russians. I notice I have this all the time with my colleagues who study Russia, and that they tend to be a little more positive, and I'm not. So Russia sees a larger threat from the U.S., right? And they see it in a range of things. I mean, they worry about social media, Arab Spring. They see the U.S. building military technologies that undercut its own position. We are the threat, as I think all of us would probably agree, that the Russians feel they need to respond to. And, you know, it was a really bad idea to have the 82nd Airborne do an airdrop about a decade ago in, I think it was Kazakhstan. The view that we're aggressive and extending NATO dominates Russian thinking. And so they see themselves as defending, right? But the way they're defending is not a helpful way for us. There's a larger battle over what we would call universal values and what the Russians would call Western values. The Chinese would agree with them on that. You know, there's this thing called the code of conduct for the information space that the Russians drafted. The first version of it was largely a rewrite of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. You know, it said things like freedom of speech is guaranteed, comma, except when contrary to national law. So they haven't quite got down the theory. And this this is really the battleground. Are we going to see the continued advance in democracy and these universal values of rule of law, human rights, market, free markets, or are we going to see that reversed? Currently, it's in reverse. We have been losing ground now for years, and that's a difficulty, right? The Russians also have a different view of sovereignty, and so when I was a UN negotiator, I saw this repeatedly. They have an older view of sovereignty, that sovereignty outweighs international commitments in many ways, outweighs universal values. This will be a debate between Russia and the US and Western Europe, but it's one where many other countries in the world are probably closer to Russia than they are to the Western view. So it's something to think about. And finally, there's an effort to rebuild Russia's status and its global position. And Putin has had some success in doing that. You have to admit that, at the expense of the US, which probably pleases him. The thing I look at the most is what is sometimes called new generation warfare. Sometimes we call it hybrid warfare. Beginning as early as the first Persian Gulf War, countries concluded that it would be a bad idea to get into a conventional struggle with the United States because you were unlikely to win. And the events in Serbia and in 2003 in Iraq only confirmed that view. So our opponents, and Russia is one of them, have looked for ways to circumvent conventional U.S. power. They believe we're doing the same thing with the weapons they build, whether we build, whether it's cyber attack, precision-guided munitions, unmanned aerial vehicles. They think the U.S. is assembling capabilities that will let it achieve strategic effect without using nuclear weapons, and that this undercuts deterrence, it undercuts stability. And they, in turn, have been developing their own doctrines that some would call hybrid warfare. Russia is the most visible example of this, but certainly not the only. An important part of this struggle is what you sometimes see referred to in Russia as the struggle for the information space. How do you shape public opinion in ways that are favorable to Russia and unfavorable to the West? And part of the campaign we saw over the last year was also not only to shape opinion to be favorable towards Russia, but to undercut universal values, the idea of democracy. And they use a whole set of tools to achieve this goal. It includes RT. It includes trolls, which you all know about. It includes hacking and the release of information. It includes these draconian threats for nuclear war or super weapons. This is all part of a campaign. You don't have to believe much of this stuff, but it's all part of a campaign to undercut Western values, damage the U.S., and harm democracy. I think this is kind of interesting, and in some ways I wonder about it, because Russia's real problem is China. They live next door. There's a lot of them. They don't hold the Russians in high regard. And whereas we might be going through a moment of what some in Europe call a moment of strategic incompetence, there's much evidence to support that. The Chinese are very directed in their goals, and you hear them mumbling a bit about reclaiming some of the territory lost in the 19th century, right? Something to watch. So I've said things that are a little different from what you've heard. You can test them over the next year by watching the elections in Europe, particularly the French, the German, and the British elections. The officials responsible for security and elections in those countries have concluded that Russia is going to undertake a campaign similar to what was done in the U.S. against their officials. You've seen some of the testing for this. The Canal 5 incident, which was the Russians hacking a French television station. You've seen it with the allegations of corruption against some European officials. It's astounding that Marie Le Pen took a $10 million loan from a Russian bank, right? And if you think there isn't political influence there, I have some property in New Jersey that might be of interest to you. So a very overt campaign to undercut NATO, the US, our Western allies. And it's been relatively successful so far. How long it will be successful remains to be seen. But one of the reasons for its success is that we have done nothing to counter it. right? And the failure to respond falls heavily on this administration. They were ready to respond and had developed responses to the DNC hacking in August, right? And so if you had asked me in August, if we'd held this event in August, I would say they're days away from pulling the trigger. And it would have included overt actions like more sanctions under the new cybersecurity sanctions authority. And it would have included covert actions. Some of the ones they were considering were ridiculous, like that one senior official asked me, would it help if we leaked Vladimir Putin's Botox injection schedule? I said, oh, surely we can do better than that, right? That's where we are at the moment. So perhaps they have reason not to be afraid of us. But watch the European elections. You've seen the senior intelligence officials in all three of the countries I've named, plus Scandinavian countries and the Netherlands, identify Russia as a primary threat to democratic institutions. What the U.S. is doing, as you heard, is still sorting out where it wants to come out on all this. There are benefits to re-engaging with the Russians. Clearly, our current strategy doesn't work, so we need a new one. But how far we go in cooperating, how far we go in accommodating, is worth discussion. And it doesn't come without risk, given the intentions to damage Western democracy and NATO. So why don't I stop there?
Thank you. To discuss the economic situation with Russia, Marc.
Well, great, thanks. good afternoon, and thanks to the American Security Project for organizing the discussion today and for including me, and thanks to my fellow panelists and to you, Matthew, for moderating. Just before I begin, a very quick word about CIPE to kind of frame what I'm about to say. So we're a nonprofit affiliate of, but not funded by, the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, and we're one of the four core institutes of the congressionally funded National Endowment for Democracy. And we also get funding from USAID and U.S. State Department. So for these reasons, as a general rule, we try not to comment on U.S. government policy. So I'm going to try to steer clear of making any sort of comments about the incoming administration, in terms of any recommendations or, what they should be doing vis-a-vis Russia. I'm going to try to instead just characterize sort of how I see things in the economic relationship, maybe kind of where we've been over the past, 8 or one could say maybe 15 years, and what a different relationship might look like and what some of the pitfalls might be. And so I'm just going to kind of have to tread carefully a little bit with some of my answers. And our organization works at the intersection of economic development and democratic development. So we look at these issues like governance and economic policy change and economic policy reform. One of our central concerns really as an organization is the role of the domestic, not US, but in the countries where we work, the domestic business community in trying to influence their government to take certain policy directions that would make it easier to do business in those countries. And as you can imagine, certainly Russia has been a challenging place for us to do our work because by and large these days one does not find many Russian business people who want to sort of publicly engage with the Kremlin on needed policy changes to improve the business climate. So Russia has been a bit of a conundrum for us as we sort of look at our work around the world. Maybe kind of take my remarks out with a grain of salt because, you've got, security and political experts here. I just look at the economic and the business side. So, please, feel free to correct me if you think that I've got anything wrong. My first thought is that if I had the opportunity, I would love to go back through all of the meetings that we've had in D.C. over the past couple of years and the articles that have been written by all of the experts predicting sort of the imminent crash of the Russian economy and that there's no way that Putin can hold on and that Putin is on the ropes. And once the economy tanks, then we're going to see political change and we're going to see greater openness and a rebirth of democracy in Russia. I think I've been probably as guilty of that as everyone. And I think we've been telling ourselves a certain story for a while. I think we might have to admit that maybe we have to go back and take take another look at some of our narratives. I think we've become attached to this notion that, you know, thanks to Putin's sort of ironclad control over the media, his popularity figures are wildly inflated, and at some point either the country's going to run out of money and the pensioners will rise up and the state employees will rise up, or he's going to run afoul of some of the oligarchs and the sort of cronyistic capitalistic system that he's built, is a house of cards, and you can't constantly please all these different factions, and something is going to collapse. Or we've said, you know, thanks to the corruption, the sort of the middle class, the burghers, will grow frustrated, and they will, you know, start backing alternative political parties. I think that we've been a little mistaken in just how deft Putin has been at negotiating those various challenges. I think, you know, with respect to some of the business community that we look at in particular, the small and medium-sized enterprise community, it's not the Soviet Union, so folks have been more than happy, and Putin has been very happy to see them go in many cases, to take their business elsewhere. They've come to the States, they've gone to Ukraine, they've gone to the Baltics, they've gone to Western Europe, and they've found many opportunities to be entrepreneurial and benefit from greater openness and rule of law and become very successful. And Putin, by and large, has been fairly happy to see them go. Then we get this sort of, magical discussion about the oil price and how the crash in the oil price is going to bring down Putin. So I went back and I looked at some of these, I just took a look at, where was the oil price in 2000 when Putin came in, around 20-something a barrel. It climbed a little bit. Then it fell after 9/11. Then it started to climb again. It got over 100. Then you had the global financial crisis. The oil price tanked. Then it starts to recover. Then all of a sudden you get the Saudis start pumping a lot of oil. The oil price goes down again. Well, what's constant through all of that is that sort of to paraphrase the Big Lebowski, Putin abides, right? I mean, I think that we have to look at how has he managed to preserve his power throughout this, right? He's managed to very deftly negotiate the oligarchs. He has given fairly wide berth to the central bank on macroeconomic policy. They've let the ruble adjust to the price of oil. He's very, deftly manipulated the use of media to identify enemies, both foreign and domestic, which to point the finger. He's taken some swings at Western and U.S. democratic institutions, as we've heard already. He's gotten involved in Syria, which has certainly helped boost his popularity. I think there's also, I think we sort of attached a lot of importance, I think, to sanctions. After the annexation of Crimea, we slapped on sanctions, and this is going to be the beginning of the end. Well, he's negotiated that fairly well. You could say some of his moves have been heavy-handed. The sort of counter sanctions and the whole sort of tit for tat over European imported food and that spurred inflation. But Russians are very adaptable and they've figured out ways to adapt. And I think every time we think that they're on the brink, they surprise us by not quite being on the brink. Now, none of this is to say that the Russian economy is out of the woods or that Putin's position is safe. I just think that we have to admit that we have less predictive power than we think we do, and I think we have less ability to influence events in Russia than I think we do. And I think it's been noted that many administrations in the U.S. have come in and pledged to, restart or reset relationships with Russia. This administration, I think, is likely to be no different, just based on what we've heard on the campaign trail. There are a few red flags out there, though. I mean, let's remember that, every time each incoming administration has restarted the relationship with Russia, at some point it's hit an impasse. If we go back to sort of what Matthew started us with, I love this phrase of the pre-something era. No one really knows what's going to happen when the new incoming U.S. administration and Putin hit some sort of impasse. So that's definitely one big... I don't know, is that a known unknown or an unknown unknown? I think also, we can look very carefully at this, story about how the Russian budget is strapped for cash and the Russian reserve fund is imminently, about to imminently be depleted. you know, a lot of these projections were made pre-election. You know, what happens if an incoming administration moves to soften the sanctions regime? And I certainly hear what Matt is saying about, you know, sanctions relief not just because, but doing it in exchange for something, right? For something. But we also know that president-elect likes to make deals. So perhaps some sort of deal will be made. Sanctions will be, eased, and you could see the Russian economy, recover from this crisis, and you could start to see maybe a turnaround in Russian GDP growth figures. You could see maybe the story of, the imminently depleted Russian, reserve fund. You could see that story maybe flip. I think it's very interesting to pay attention to the dynamic, and we were talking about this before we walked in. The dynamic, the emerging dynamic between Russia and Putin and OPEC. For the first time, Russia has basically sort of convinced OPEC to start cutting production. I'm not an oil person, so I don't know exactly the exact dynamics of how this went down. I hope someone will correct me if I'm wrong, but this is something that Putin desperately wants. He wants OPEC to cut production to drive the oil price back up. To my point about, Russia not being entirely out of the weeds, of course, I think we have to pay attention to the fact that once the oil price hits a certain level, you would see U.S. production start up again, and that's going to have a countervailing effect. So that's going to be, I think, a very interesting dynamic to watch going forward, because I think the incoming administration is likely to be even more friendly to U.S. energy production than the Obama administration has been, and the Obama administration actually has been quite friendly to U.S. oil and gas production. I think it's also very interesting to watch the deal that just was announced this morning. They were looking at a potentially sort of embarrassing self-privatization of $11 billion, I think, dollar stake in Rosneft. Now it turns out that that Glencore and the Qatari Sovereign Wealth Fund have come through, and they're going to be buying that $11 billion stake. I think it's very interesting. Going back to this question of sanctions, that as yet, at least, I checked before I got here, an as yet identified European bank somehow helped to broker that sale. That further buoys this emerging relationship between Russia and a key OPEC member. It brings this influx of cash, it also sort of potentially signals a further kind of weakening of the sanctions regime down the line. I think it is interesting to note a couple of things. First of all, there was a story a couple of days ago saying that some of the proceeds from the sale of that $11 billion stake, once it went through, wouldn't necessarily go straight into the Russian budget. They would go to some sort of murky holding company that's mostly controlled by Sechin and Putin. That was a very interesting story that was out there on Bloomberg. So let's see what happens when when the budget actually needs that cash. Just a couple of other thoughts in terms of where this relationship might go going forward. The Obama administration has been very aggressive in terms of FCPA enforcement and very, I think, forward-thinking in terms of talking about issues of global corruption and kleptocracy. I think it will be very interesting to see what positions the new administration stakes out in that regard and how that helps to shape an emerging U.S.-Russia relationship down the line. Maybe just sort of as a word of conclusion, and I think to some degree this echoes what's been said before, with the way the election here in the U.S. turned out, I think that Putin lost a favorite punching bag, and I think the narrative that they'd been sort of predicting didn't quite work out the way it would happen. And as I was listening to Matt's comments, I was wondering, will there be some sort of, be careful what you wish for kind of a moment? I think there's going to be some easing of pressure on the Russian economy, but, the question is, what happens to any sort of newfound friendship once new challenges and new points of departure emerge? So thank you. I'll stop on that, and back to you,
Mark. So before we turn it over to audience Q&A, I'm going to take moderator's privilege and ask a few questions myself, starting with you, Matt. One thing that we saw during the election was concern over the strength of Article 5 with regards to NATO. And I think some fair criticism that some NATO partners are not paying the 4% of GDP, essentially it's 2%, that they should be towards their defense expenditures, essentially. And we know that Latvia is one of the few countries that actually is doing that. Are there ways that we can strengthen the commitment to Article 5 in a way that is opaque, yet doesn't create the situation where we have a security dilemma with Russia, where they fear that, you know, new commitments or greater defense spending is seen as a threat?
Sure, I think, so first of all, you can interpret Mr. Trump's comments about NATO Article 5 in either of two directions during the campaign, that is his comments during the campaign, in retrospect now can be interpreted in either of two directions. One is he genuinely is not sure that NATO is a worthwhile investment, to put it in kind of transactional terms. But there's evidence now from the readbacks that we're getting from calls he's had with European heads of state that his hard line on European states paying up for their own defense, which is never going to be anything close to an equal transaction, ever. The premise of NATO is that the United States remains militarily present on the European continent, and the United States is the military superpower, certainly in the Western world. He's now getting a degree of compliance across the board with at least the notion of 2% that I think remained unthinkable for all of the Obama administration, despite, you know, similar, phrased differently, couched differently, but basically a similar impulse that we heard from this White House. That is that European states, and by the way, from the Bush administration and the Clinton administration before it. So there's another way to interpret what Mr. Trump has done, is to dramatically ratchet up the pressure, but not fundamentally change the dynamic. The United States will still be there for its European allies. It simply will get more commitment of that kind in exchange. How do you avoid, I certainly believe that Article 5, whether NATO's enlargement to particular new member states post 1989-91 was a good idea or not, in retrospect, doesn't matter when you ask the question of whether Article 5 is credible today. The only thing that matters is whether the United States views it as credible and is committed to it. And I think there, yes, of course, judge not by what we say, but by what we do. And I'm reminded in particular of George Kennan's understanding of containment, where he originally laid out a vision of the Soviet threat, although he spoke very much in terms of the Russian leadership, and he did so intentionally because his study of Russia goes back, you know, centuries, millennia. And his assessment was that these folks are deterrable, but they're only deterrable if you take very clear actions that convey a threat, that you do so with language and with a style that is non-threatening, that is not blustering, that isn't, you know, bombastic. It's a little bit of the speak softly and carry a big stick message. But the bottom line takeaway is, you know, how do you do reassurance in NATO's vulnerable East in a way that isn't viewed as either an excuse or a provocation? The answer is be crystal clear about exactly what you are seeking to deter and exactly where. And, you know, I would venture, I'd ask Jim this question, I'd venture to guess that logic should apply equally well to deterring Russian meddling activities, et cetera, in the cyber realm. Maybe the rules, the tools, et cetera, are a little bit less clear. But, you know, clarity. And one of my concerns is that we often overreach with the logic of deterrence. We rhetorically, again, to this point of bombast and bluster, we extend to realms where it's pretty clear that we have no credibility and there have been no concrete moves to actually deter. I think Jim made this point in the cyber realm. So if you want your core deterrent to remain credible, be real careful how far you stretch the concept. That's how I would do it responsibly. And I just close by saying, again, whatever your politics may be, whatever you may expect from the new administration, I think it's an undisputed point. They have an opportunity to start fresh in some policy areas, and that would be one of them.
Excellent. Jim, that brings up a question, and I think it's about deterrence and about escalation. When we're talking about these non-nuclear tools that are available, whether that's cyber or otherwise, would it be useful to carve out an opaque and explicitly labeled system of escalation for some of these tools? You mentioned that we hadn't responded sufficiently to Russia. So if Russia understood the way in which we would respond to certain actions, whether that's in the cyber realm or others, do you think that would be useful for de-escalation, essentially?
I'm usually not a big fan of deterrence because my usual joke is that it's ancestor worship, because it was a great idea in 1960. It's a little past its sell-by date. And one of the problems we have, and for me this would really start with if the initial discomfort was the first Persian Gulf War when U.S. conventional capabilities appeared overwhelming. Remember, Iraq had, I think, the third or fourth largest army in the world at the time of that conflict, a Soviet model army, and it was squashed. And that was a wake-up call. It was reinforced by Serbia, I think, where, as you heard, there's concerns about U.S. adherence to international law. I had a conversation once with a Chinese diplomat where, you know, under the UN, you're allowed to use force after you go to the Security Council or in exercising your inherent right to self-defense. Right? And he said, you Americans do whatever you want, and then you call it self-defense. And there's a little bit of truth to that, right? So you can't be entirely critical of these guys. But what it means is that the people we are facing now, Russia among them, have probably spent close to 20 years thinking how to circumvent American military power, including what we think of as deterrence. So we can deter a nuclear attack on the United States. We can deter probably a massive conventional invasion of our NATO allies. But we can't deter a heck of a lot else, right? And the especially given the way we're structured now, you know, let's say, to use an example, Russia hacks the DNC. What do? Send a carrier battle group? So we need new tools for deterrence. And one of the ways some of us have been talking about it is you need to repopulate the ladder of escalation. And that will be hard for the U.S. because we're so militarized in our thinking that you are going to think about, well, how do I use the carrier battle group? Forget the carrier battle group. Right? We have to think about other techniques that are coercive, but don't necessarily involve military force. And that's been sort of the struggle for the last 5 years with great power opponents. How do you apply coercive pressure without the direct use of military force? Right? And we need to think of ways to counter that. Clarity would be useful. I think Richard Betts wrote a year or two ago that bluffing is only good in deterrence if you don't really mean to deter anything. And so we're really good at bluffing. If I was going to be a little critical of this administration, it's been unsurprisingly for a president who was a law professor, very legalistic. So we do have a declaratory policy. It's about a third of a page long, and it has so many caveats that I don't think anyone could really tell what the heck we mean. So we need to rethink deterrence to make it a different kind of approach, one that matches our opponents' own tactics, and that to echo the Kennan point, it has to be clear. Right? It can't be this imprecision. You hear sometimes that people talk about strategic ambiguity and how good this is, and strategic ambiguity is just confusing to the other sides. They don't know what we mean. So we'll have to give up strategic ambiguity if we want to get anywhere.
Thank you. Marc, one thing that came to mind when you were mentioning Russia's ability to adapt, you know, despite all the years of us predicting the economy to crash, is Do you think maybe an opposite approach might be more effective, where we're focusing more on carrots than sticks, essentially, to incentivize Russia to take proper action? I know you can't comment too much on particular policy, but sort of thinking of economic interdependence, would that
sure.
be something that appeals to Russia and motivating it properly?
Well, you know, I think obviously, the carrot is preferable to the Russians than the stick, but I mean, almost to the same, the same questions that were just raised by Jim, like, what are we trying to achieve? You know, I mean, the sanctions were, designed as a way to achieve a certain end vis-a-vis Ukraine. I think offering greater economic engagement to the Russians, they'll say, great, thanks. I don't think it's not quite clear to me what the exchange is in that sense. So, I think they'll be very happy to have more economic engagement, but I don't think that's going to motivate any particular change in their behavior. They'll, potentially quite rightly interpret it as meaning, okay, well, we won. We win. Great. Thank you. So, that's sort of my take on that.
Okay. Well, we've got time for a few audience questions, so if you can raise your hand and ask your question in the form of a question as opposed to a speech, we can get through a few of them. Gentlemen, right here. Wait for the microphone for just a second.
Sure. Michael Kimmage from the State Department. I have Matt's question, or Matt's phrase in mind, of the Washington establishment, and I wanted to ask a question about potential ideological affinity between Trump's Washington and Moscow. And this has to do with a number of issues, some of which aren't perhaps that directly relevant to foreign policy, but on religion, on gender and sexuality, on especially the notion of the nation state, where both Trump and Putin celebrate the nation state as opposed to what they term globalist elites. Washington and Moscow have just moved a lot closer together since the election. How much of this is hot air on both sides? In other words, not worth taking all that seriously. How much of this, to the degree that you can predict the coming months and years, will matter? Because Trump's rhetoric and position is really so different from what we've grown accustomed to in the last 8, 12, 16 years in D.C.
If I was anybody on the other side, I would not be pleased by the selection of General Mattis. He's nobody's fool, and he's not going to take things lightly from anyone. And so my question, I think both of my colleagues raised it, is, here you have two individuals who are very proud of themselves, and the potential for a clash between these two just seems inevitable. I don't think President-elect Trump will take the kind of insults that President Obama took. I don't think he'll take them lightly. So my question is, how long does the honeymoon last?
Michael, I mean, this is an important question, but it's also, in my view, the wrong question. And the reason is because while it's, of course, Jim is right, much remains to be seen, right? You appoint General Mattis, that says one thing. You appoint someone else, it says a different thing. And we may end up with a cabinet and an administration that is as much establishment as, a Hillary administration would have been. That said, it's clearly analytically correct that Trump ran and won a political campaign which was anti-establishment. That's obviously true, and the Russians see that. I think the Russians would define what's going on in far broader terms than, the Trump candidacy and the Putin worldview, or the dominant Russian worldview. They would say that there's a global problem, and it's a problem with corrupt, defunct institutions which have been dominated by an insular global elite that's also, and I think this is where I would ask the question, been hamstrung in terms of solving problems that actually matter. Now, the Russians define those problems and suggest solutions a little differently than we do, and for that matter, I think a little differently even than the American electorate that elected Mr. Trump does. So the question I would ask is, does a Trump administration, if it ends up going in more of an anti-establishment direction, does it help to prove the case that getting away from the tried and true principles of kind of the post-World War II Western liberal democratic consensus as played out in North America and Europe actually helps you solve problems? Does it help you get healthcare right? Does it help you get infrastructure right? Does it help you get education right? Those things may happen by accident or for reasons not attributable to Mr. Trump or his ideology. But if they do happen, the Kremlin may be happy in some instances because it will strengthen arguments that they've already made. And in other instances, they may be very concerned because it will strengthen the American hand and I would hope by extension the European hand quite dramatically. So again, I don't mean to sound Pollyanna-ish here, but I think the key word here is opportunity. And since we're having a conversation in the midst of a transition, we don't know really how that opportunity will be exploited or not.
If I could just quickly piggyback on that, I think one of the interesting elements to this, at least looking from the point of view of Russia, is, and I don't know whether past in one country is any predictor of future in another country, but certainly if you look at issues like solving issues of healthcare and economic development and diversification and infrastructure and things like that, certainly the Putin model of government has not necessarily been successful in tackling those issues. Yet, as I said before, that appears to have no bearing on his domestic popularity, even controlling for whatever his sort of control of the media is. And I think this notion of sort of elitism and global elitism is another thing where, sort of the Washington thinkocracy maybe has gotten it wrong, because we continually told ourselves that by pointing out that, patriotic Russia, Putin sends his children and the elite's children all study in West and they love their fancy cars and their designer houses, that would somehow, undercut Putin's, regime's logic, and it would lead to his downfall. That didn't quite work out for us either. So I would just add those two little wrinkles to the conversation.
Good. Time for one more quick question. The woman in the back.
Hi, thank you. My name is Lori Handrahan, and I'm just back from Kyrgyzstan. And I started out there about 20 years ago, so I've been in the region a long time. And I think that it's an excellent place to watch Russia from. So my question, just to frame it, is what I didn't hear anybody speak about is the role of organized crime. And what all of my friends were explaining to me in Kyrgyzstan, and I hadn't been back for over a decade, is that the political process and the state has been completely co-opted by organized crime, and that every political leader has an appointed thief in king that's appointed in Moscow his corresponding organized crime boss, and that this is a highly structured network now out of Moscow. So I'm wondering what U.S. foreign policy is to counter the threat of organized crime, and then also including the fact that my friends in law enforcement in America are very concerned about how Russian organized crime has taken over the trafficking of women and girls in America, particularly in Miami.
Thank you. Any takers on that one?
Well, I mean, I'm not a crime expert by any stretch of the imagination, but I did, I think, in my remarks allude very briefly to the role that the Obama administration has tried to take in terms of things like FCPA enforcement and talking about kleptocracy. I think it will be very interesting to see where some of those efforts, I've spoken with, some folks in law enforcement, and some folks on the legal side who tried to do things in asset recovery, and I think there's an interesting sort of Ukraine angle to this, sort of post-Maidan, what we've tried to do to help the Ukrainians recover assets. To the extent that doesn't speak necessarily to your entire question, but I think there's also a lot of uncertainty around where that will go from here.
The problem with labeling organized crime per se as the problem that we want to tackle is that it is, of course, a part of the problem we want to tackle. But I think that the pretty compelling de facto response from Russia is that where isn't there organized crime? So you all can point out and label these networks that we use, for leverage and influence, but look at what's going on in dirty European politics, or look at what's going on in dirty American politics. It's just way bigger scale. They're stealing more, and they're doing it without getting their suits dirty at all. Whereas, sort of traditional organized crime, as we think of it, is somewhere in between the street thug and the corrupt politician. the fact is it does all exist on a spectrum, and I don't think that there is a policy answer that addresses just the kind of the mafia piece of it, you know, if you will, without addressing the lack of institutions that actually deliver transparent state services or, you know, street crime and law and order, right? You somehow have to address it as a package, and that comes right back to the basic question of, do you have a vision, do you have resources, and do you have a political system that actually solves problems? Or do you instead have one that just kind of perpetuates the status quo? And I really think that this is the challenge, right? And I think actually the next administration has a pretty short ticking clock on demonstrating that it has a different approach to this that is going to be more effective. But it does have that opening. And that goes as much for foreign affairs. I'd love it if they paid some attention to Kyrgyzstan, Central Asia. I don't know if that's going to be the case. Maybe you can go up and brief them or invite some of your friends to do so.
So a quick lesson on hacking. There's a Russian hacker who extracted hundreds of millions of dollars from Americans. He currently resides in the Bureau of Prisons facility in Spokane, Washington, because he made the mistake of taking a vacation to the Maldives. And so we have caught Russian hackers when they've been dumb enough to take a vacation overseas. And in this particular case, the hacker was the son of a prominent Russian politician. So we saw the Russian government make diplomatic demarches to release him, to let him go to, you know, I don't know what. Those didn't work. But there is this link between the Kremlin and organized crime. And I think the problem, you can tell I'm the hardliner on the panel here, right? Maybe not, that's not fair. But I'm certainly taking hardline positions. We're going to have to find ways to push back on Russian crime. And that will lead us inevitably to the Kremlin. So you will find justice under Sessions, I think, as willing to tackle Russian organized crime, particularly its hacking and financial crime, as you did under Lynch or Holder. So stay tuned to this one.
All right, I think that's all we've got time for, so I'd like to thank the panelists for coming today and thank all of you.
That was fun.
And as you're all doing your winter and holiday shopping, please keep ASP in mind. We are a 501c3 nonprofit, so check out our website. There's a big donate button. We need your help in 2017. Thank you all.
Have a good day.